Mr. Alexander Ovechkin.
Mr. John Cooper.
Mr. TJ Oshie.
Mr. Austin Matthews.
Mr. Victor Hedman.
What is your best hangover cure?
I've never been the hangover.
I can't believe I'm a man in blazers and I didn't wear a blazer.
Playing to men in hoodies, it's the next phase.
Flipping sticks back to your teammate. Yep. That is Jedi level crap.
It's a good catch.
I don't think this one's appropriate for TV. So, let's...
It's Rog from Men in Blazers, a gent who fell in love with hockey the first day I moved to the United States and glimpsed its mix of speed, power and wonder. It was like the Premier League, played with the amplifiers turned up to 11. The Washington Caps of Peter Bondra, Craig Berube and Ole Kolzig cemented that love. And so it's the honour of a lifetime for us to create this series, in which we sit down with some of the leading stars of the game, talk about their career journeys and the lessons of life they've gleaned that transcend sports. First up, a human being who's one of the most emotionally articulate athletes I've ever encountered. A man who came of age in a home built on empathy, a value he tapped into to propel himself all the way to Stanley Cup glory.
It's Mr. Ryan O'Reilly.
How you doing?
Oh, Ryan, I'm good now. Your childhood nickname given to you by your grandmother Deirdre. What was it?
Snook.
Snook!
I was a little snook into everything and causing some havoc.
Bowling ball of energy.
Exactly. And she sort of called me Snook, and then it just kind of stuck, and that's what my entire family calls me now.
That nickname has stuck with you since around the age of two. Every family needs a Grandma Deirdre to create order, sense, meaning.
For my brother and I, and my sisters as well, and she was a huge supporter of our hockey. She bought skates countless times, and we were the greatest players ever in her mind, so it was always a nice confidence boost.
You know what's amazing? She wasn't wrong in your case. My grandma, not so correct. Your parents, though, both social workers. Mm-hmm. You got two sisters and a brother, but your family also took in dozens of foster kids to live with you over the years, creating a massive extended family that taught you some formative human lessons. In the O'Reilly house, you had to share, communicate, learn how to be part of a big team.
My family's always been helping out people. We had four or five foster kids at a time. Some of them had unfortunate stories. Growing up with my parents, one thing they taught me is that we need to be responsible for each other. We need to help each other, that it's not about just me. We need to put ourselves aside, listen, and connect.
It also made for some massive hockey lessons, enormous games on the reg, playing against older kids all the time, and being at a physical disadvantage. You learned how to play well defensively to keep up. Tiny Snoop.
You know, I wouldn't be playing in the NHL if it wasn't for my brother. He was so skilled that I was always constantly going against him and people that were better than me. Being smaller than them, you learn how to be in the right positions that make it difficult to get around you or put them in an awkward spot where you can take the puck away.
Makes the sense. Roots of the Ryan O'Reilly game were made on that pond. Without ever having played in the minors, you made the jump right into the NHL in 2009. Drafted by the Colorado Avalanche, and as an 18-year-old, became the then youngest player in team's history. 2015, you were traded to the Buffalo Sabres, that magnificent big dreaming sports town, which offered you the opportunity to lead a team who'd finished last and help them to go next level. Your three seasons in Buffalo turned out to be a bit darkness on the edge of town. The team began a rebuild within a rebuild. You were dragged down into a vortex of losing. It's a bit of a ring of fire, right?
When you keep losing, it's tough to come to the rink and you have that pressure.
We're stuck in this mindset of just, you know, being okay with losing. And throughout the year, I've lost the love of the game.
Within 3 months, you were traded to St. Louis. Remind me what you told the GM when he traded for you.
Yeah, let's go win a cup. I said, there's something to take. I'm so excited.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I said, let's go win a cup at the end of it.
Well, the Blues haven't won a Stanley Cup in their 52 years of existence. You seem like a perfect match. Their fans had decades of yearning, but a losing followed you to St. Louis. The team had a league low 34 points on January the 2nd. You've been acquired to help a team transform their fortunes. It wasn't happening. Did you ever start to feel like cursed, like a hockey-playing Job forced to wander the world and suffer?
Yeah, I felt like I was a cancer. Just, you know, just wherever I went, you know, losing forward.
There was a coaching change. In came the legendary Craig Berube. Rookie goalie Jordan Binnington was called up. And St. Louis reel off a franchise record 12 straight games. Team began a magical ascent into the postseason from the bottom of the standings.
Ryan O'Reilly, and it's a franchise record for the St. Louis Blues.
How much better is the rest of your life when your team's winning?
Winning does great things, that's for sure.
I wouldn't know. Into the playoffs, you turn the amplifiers up to 11.
Now O'Reilly with the puck, he scores!
In the Stanley Cup Finals against Boston, you went Pete Ryan O'Reilly.
It is O'Reilly! It's 3-2!
Playing in the playoffs and the Stanley Cup Final is the most fun I've ever had playing hockey. You know, the kid in me just comes out where it's pure excitement, and it brings you back to a little guy just playing the game and not trying to expect anything.
Headed into Game 7 against the Bruins with a score tied 3-3. Hockey played without a safety net, with the world watching. Did it feel like you were playing for everything you'd ever worked for? The dreams, the success, it all boiled down to this.
It's what I've prepared for my whole life. So it's like, enjoy it. Just absorb everything that's going on and
like
just
this, man.
Love it.
Not this, man. You've said you knew it had to be the best game of my life. And inside 4 minutes, you do this.
Got it to Bouwmeester. Shoots one. Score! Bouwmeester! It was deflected in front by O'Reilly, and it becomes 1-0. The Blues with the lead.
Game 7, Stanley Cup Final. When that goes in, is that like any other goal of which you've scored countless? Or does that feel different?
Oh, it feels different, that's for sure. I can vividly remember that feeling of seeing it go in, see my face on it. I'm like, that fire's in you. And going back to the bench and feeling the excitement from the faces on the guys as you're fist bumping them. Probably my most memorable goal I've ever scored. It gave us that belief, let's go win this thing.
You must have said let's go maybe 12,000 times in your career. But that let's go, was it just like the CEO of all let's goes?
Might have been a few curse words in there too.
For the first time in their history, the St. Louis Blues are the Stanley Cup champions.
What a personal series of glory. Only you, an NHL legend and icon to all boards, Mark Messier, have had a 6-game point streak in the Stanley Cup Final. I've often asked myself this, Ryan, when Gary Bettman says,
Ryan O'Reilly, come get the Conn Smythe Trophy.
What does it feel like? Are you like, hell yes, I deserve the MVP? Or does it feel out of body, like a boy living out a dream?
Growing up, watching the Stanley Cup Final, and you see the players that have won it, people that I've looked up to and pretended to be millions of times, Crosby, Gretzky, and then you hear my name called for that.
Snook has his name on the Conn Smythe Trophy. You were pretty amped in your post-game interview.
You know, once we got that lead, we knew we were going to get it. You know, sorry, I apologize. I'm so amped up. I'm so sorry. We knew. The boys are
I've
so
I've heard that word in hockey before.
Sorry, I'm terribly sorry.
It's okay.
I apologize.
Peak Canadian politeness. We on that flight home, you pose with Pat Maroon and your trophies and some brews. I've only held one of those three things in my lifetime, and it felt pretty good. You had all three. What did it feel like?
That picture just spread like wildfire. It was just everywhere after we were done.
I mean, I will say, when I look at that photograph, I see a man who was seen by some as a failure, who had become the Conn Smythe Trophy awardee and a Stanley Cup champion. A man who had led a turnaround, not just your career, but an entire team and a city. What did it feel like?
I remember that flight because it was just the team, which was so cool about winning on the road, that it was just us on the plane being with each other. It was pure joy for sure.
One of the great traditions in hockey, every player has a day to do whatever they want with a Stanley Cup. You took it back to your hometown of Goderich, a Canadian kid, bringing back in Canada the Ark of the Covenant to your small town. You hugged your 99-year-old grandmother, Deirdre, the one who'd named you Snook all those years earlier.
We did it. We got it done.
Such a wonderful day.
This is the first time I've seen her since winning. And I said, I love you. And then to bring her back, the Stanley Cup. We never really thought that that would happen.
She did, though.
she probably did.
You rode through the area on the back of a fire truck.
You're driving down the street and you're just seeing people you grow up with, kids I went to school with, teachers that have always supported me, and you just see the joy in their face, and you really realize it's not me that won this. It's, you know, all those people in my hometown that are a part of it, that have always watched me and followed me. You realize it's about doing what you love and sharing it with people and taking care of each other.
Ryan O'Reilly, what a bloke. A game built on power, grind, and compassion. When we come back, the mighty Victor Hedman, another player who's dug deep to dominate. prove the naysayers wrong, and develop one of the game's most distinct superstitions. My next guest is from Tampa Bay, and his story is an inspirational one. A Swedish giant who's lived out Rudyard Kipling's life wisdom. If you can keep your head when all about you are losing theirs and blaming it on you. This is Victor Hedman.
How you doing?
Oh, good now I'm with you. Because your journey from northern Sweden to the NHL is a remarkably human one. You are a son of Orn Schulsvik, Sweden. The locals call it Ovik, a small industrial town 6 hours north of Stockholm.
Paper mill town, 30,000 people.
Ovik has been the birthplace of 13 NHL players, including legends Peter Forsberg, Henrik Sedin, his twin Daniel Sedin.
It sure is a hockey town.
It's what Brazil's futsal courts are to the Premier League. It's a place where the sports soul is on perpetual display. But you're an enormous kid, and it wasn't easy at first for you on the ice. You had trouble with coordination. Was it that your body couldn't keep up with your mind?
I grew so fast when I was young. I just remember the pain in my legs. Once I stepped on the ice, I fell down a lot. I had a lot of second thoughts about playing the game.
Your brother once said, in the early days, you skated like a moose. Do you remember your mind transmitting messages that your body just wasn't picking up on?
I wanted to do one thing and my body said another thing and just ended up falling down. Well, you were frustrated that you couldn't get it to work and you see the smaller guys flying around the ice and why can't I do that?
You've said that you were at times quite an awkward kid.
Yeah, I mean, it was, it's tough and, you know, I have a birthmark on my side too that was a lot redder when I was younger and I had no beard at that time. So, you know, that was kind of tough for me too. You know, everyone have birthmarks, but mine is, you know, this size and on my left cheek. It was tough growing up having that, but that's one of the things that's made me stronger.
By November 2006, age 15, it had all started to come together. You were 6'5", you weighed 210 pounds. It was your puck handling and smooth skating that made you a global elite prospect. You're like Pau Gasol. You're a big man with soft hands. You played your first game in the Swedish Elite League age 16, became the youngest player in the modern era to play for the Swedish national team only 2 months after turning 18. Then NHL Draft Day 2009 with the second pick.
The Tampa Bay Lightning are proud to select from Modo in the Swedish Elite League, Victor Hedman.
You were 18, but you look about 25 here. The broadcaster, when you were drafted, announced that scouts thought you'd be quickest to adjust to the NHL. But in truth, Tampa Bay had serious defensive liabilities when you arrived. You were flung into chaos.
Tampa just kind of whacking that puck from in front of the net. Hedman just bangs it back out to that high slot. There's Drury.
I want to talk about the adjustment. First, practically, in Sweden, the size of the ice is actually bigger. You have more time to be creative, more space, right?
Big time, and you come over here, everything goes so much faster, and it's a smaller ice sheet, so you have some guy in your face at all time, and you just wanted to get rid of the puck and, you know, get off the ice pretty much.
Off the ice, you were still just a kid who'd left high school. You'd never lived more than 5 minutes away from your parents before.
Yeah.
From tiny Ovik, you're suddenly in Tampa, Guava City.
It was a culture shock, that's for sure. Just 2 weeks before I came over, I got my driver's license, so I'd never driven a car before in my life. And I came over to Tampa, and all of a sudden, there's traffic, you know. Back home, you're cursing if it's six cars ahead of you.
What was the one thing that surprised you most?
The size of some of the vegetables when you got here, that was unbelievable.
How many mushrooms are there in the supermarket?
Exactly.
What did you miss most about Sweden besides family and friends?
Swedish candy. Wine gums is one of my favorites. Swedish fish is overrated.
It is?
Yeah.
Really?
I think so. You buy them over here, they're all red. Yeah, they're not just red, it's every different color.
Sweden number one.
Yeah.
There was a time when critics began to debate if you were delivering on the second overall draft pick, Darko Milicic style. Those critics kept telling you had to be more aggressive on the ice.
Lightning don't get anybody on the body. Hedman is there, but he doesn't see the guy coming in.
Were the days when you got back to your apartment and you just kind of hated the whole thing?
It's tough mentally, you know, you're such a high draft pick and you see all the other high picks scoring goals and getting all the acknowledgement. But you gotta be resilient here. I knew I had better in me.
There's a hockey adage. It takes a defenseman 250 games to really find his feet. And in the 2013 season, in came John Cooper as coach, and your career flipped.
Hedman scores! Victor Hedman's second goal of the game.
You scored 13 goals, 42 assists. You suddenly look confident at both ends of the ice. Can you describe your style? Because you're like a poet warrior.
I'm not a physical force in the sense of hitting people. When I hit people, it's to get the puck back, and I'm not out there looking for the big hits. I let my skating do the work and try to have my hockey IQ to set up my teammates and be a force on the ice.
We are living in a golden era of NHL defensemen. You, Brent Burns, John Carlson, scoring for fun. I mean, you guys are now expected to fly up and down the ice like Trent Alexander-Arnold on skates. What extent has the NHL changed with its emphasis on puck movement, puck possession, and creating offense?
When I got into the league, it's a lot of big bodies. You know, you had the fighters on the fourth line and a lot more checking, hard hits. The young kids that come in these days, you know, the McDavids, Ross Kucherov, they're just ready to play, and they have all the skill in the world, and they move like the wind, and things they can do with the puck, it's insane. So I love the way hockey's trending right now.
On June 20th, 2018, you, Victor Hedman, became the first player in Lightning history to win the Norris Trophy, the NHL's defensive MVP. How did that feel as you cradled that trophy?
What I was most nervous about was the speech I made on the stage. I'm not a great public speaker.
Wow, this is pretty amazing.
So I was in the bathroom for probably 2 hours, just repeating the speech, and I had it all inside my pocket. And you know, once I got up there, I got the trophy in my hand, so I couldn't go and get my speech. So then I was kind of panicking a little bit, but I was super happy with the way I performed up there.
To my parents, my wife, I wouldn't be here without you guys. Thank you.
You had some journey from a kid who is a big man making himself small in every photo to becoming a second pick in the NHL draft, who some started to consider a bust, but then establishing yourself as the best defenseman in the league. Is that enough? Do you feel satisfied being comfortable in your own skin in the NHL?
The thing I grew up dreaming about is the Stanley Cup, so it's the ultimate goal for me as a hockey player, is to raise that cup over my head. I won't be satisfied until, you know, that trophy comes back to Tampa.
I love that bloke. It's an incredible juxtaposition of power and grace, tenacity and kindness. Coming up, I travel to DC to meet that human spark plug known as TJ Oshie. This is Rog. You're watching Men in Blazers on Ice. My next guest is a hero of mine. I've long revered the way his elite skills are matched by his commitment to the collective and the human joy with which he takes to the ice.
It's a genuine delight to sit in our nation's capital, Washington, D.C., with one of my favourite athletes in American sports. Right-wing spark plug, all-star chugger from your Washington Capitals by way of Washington State and Minnesota. Oh, it's Mr. T.J. Oshie.
Thanks for having me.
Oh, mate. July 2015, you were traded to the Capitals, a team many feared that had frittered away its prime Stanley Cup winning years. You can pinpoint the emergence of a new collective spirit when you arrived. And listening to your teammates, much of it is down to your style of play. Your game, it's built on constant energy. It is contagious. You're listed at around 6 foot. Defensemen who have 4 or 5 inches and plenty of pounds instigate hits on you. They think they're going to rock you, and you end up sending them to the shadow realm. How do you do that?
Little man syndrome. I was always little. I didn't get above 5'5 until 16. When you're that small, you have to hit them before they hit you.
Mate, I watch people try and blindside you. Somehow they bounce off you. It's Matrix-level crap. I am fascinated by how the Caps team is a collective forged out of very different guys. The quality and quantity of pre-game rituals that you unveil, it's staggering. I mean, you have one handshake for almost every player. Kuznetsov.
Kuzi's the first guy that I handshake. We go in each other and lock each other's elbows, almost like you were dancing.
Oh, you and Carlson.
A little hop at the start, and then a high five into the elbows.
Nicholas Backstrom.
I don't think this one's appropriate for TV. So, let's, we can...
You and Ovi.
Three hard high fives until my shoulder almost breaks, and then a really hard elbow, and then a chest bump. And then we say, let's effing go.
Is that what it is? Because I always thought that was just some close quarter breath smelling.
You get spit on a little bit, depending on when the guy drank his Gatorade last.
I watch that, and I realize in that second, you are experiencing more testosterone than will flow through my body, probably in my entire life.
Just trying to stay on your feet, chest bumping Big O, is a pretty tough task. So I got to give it my all to not look like a fool.
But all of this is just warming up, because perhaps your most famous pre-game ritual, the one that sets the tone for the team, you and Tom Wilson, you savour the opportunity to trade off on the delivery of the ultimate slap shot to each other's badunkadonk. Sometimes it's a rasping rocket to the rear. Sometimes you test the integrity of each other's groin area with your stick.
We've got some different things going, depending on if we lost the last game. If we won, we'll do the same thing. So there's a little bit of superstition there, depending on what we tap, how hard we tap it, and how we do it.
You're not a urologist, you just play one on TV. All of these rituals, they do have a practical purpose. There is a method to the Yoshi madness, bringing a unity to the team.
When you do it one or two times, it's just kind of a little handshake and you're just having fun. I think when you do it for a full season, you get to the playoffs and you're going out for a third period and you really need to be on top of your game and you stick to your routine. It really becomes a bond. And some people say that you need a little hatred on the team, or sometimes you got to play with guys that you dislike. I'm not that way. I think you have to care about the person next to you, and that's a way to build that bond and that care.
It's with this spirit, this collective, ferocious, joyful team culture that you became 2018 Stanley Cup champions. A moment that empowered you to do something that, for me, is probably a top 10 moment in American sports history, and not 10 through 2, which is chug a beer through your jersey. What are the roots of that moment of avant-garde freestyle imagination?
We were having a team night out. I did it right in front of Tom Wilson's face at the restaurant with a glass of wine, ruined my shirt. So we got on stage and we're told we were all gonna kind of go up one after another. My plan was to kind of keep it together, but then I saw Brooks Orpik, who's very strict with his diet and his training, and he went up and started chugging a beer, and then Tom was sitting next to me and he looked over and he's like, you have to do it.
When you know you're gonna end the night soaked in beer, the first wound might as well be self-inflicted. That beer chug was one indelible moment of victory, but you also delivered another one for so many Caps fans that was on the opposite end of the emotional spectrum. During the Stanley Cup trophy presentation, you went over to hug your father, Tim Sr., who's suffering from Alzheimer's.
I love you, sir. I love
you. You said later that your dad was one of those dads that was always in the backyard playing with you, that he used to lose in the backyard to keep you happy. You and he had pretended that you'd won the Stanley Cup so many times together, and you'd actually made that backyard dream come true. You got to say to him, we did it, Dad.
It was a special moment to share together because he does have Alzheimer's and he forgets things. My Aunt Pam, who was there taking care of him, she said, the second we woke up in Vegas, I think we were already on a plane back to DC, your dad woke up and said, we got the cup. He didn't forget that one, and I had a feeling he wouldn't.
You're never negative. You're never pessimistic to constantly be cup half full. What is the secret to that?
I'd rather be someone that's a joy to be around than someone that's a burden and someone you got to tiptoe around. I love life. I love where I'm at. I love what I've been able to do.
Oshie! With a minute 14 to go!
I love what I'm hopefully going to be able to do.
Could be another short beer chug in DC's future.
I think it's a must.
If ever an athlete understands the true power of team, it's TJ Oshie. And the moral of this show is, try and channel the empathy of Ryan O'Reilly, the tenacity of Victor Hedman, and the ability to take nothing for granted of TJ Oshie. The world would be a better place if you did, and you too might savour glory on ice. Courage.